It is so nice to be joining you here today. As was mentioned, my name is Ben Greenberg, and I am the Ruby developer advocate at Vonage. And I'm also one of the two platform engineers in charge with our documentation platform. And today I want to talk about the journey that we took from our documentation platform to what we call Station. To do so, I want to start with what I consider to be, and I think many of you would consider to be, an axiomatic truth, a really basic fundamental truth to the work that we are engaged in. And that is that if it is not documented, it is not done. Simply saying that if you want your product, you want your API, your feature to reach GA, general availability status, it has to have at the same time the documentation to go along with it. I'm probably preaching to the crowd, but that is not obvious to everyone. And that is really important to everything that we do and underpins all the work that we engage in, which is why if we take a step back in time in 2017, when our company, which started its life as Nexmo, before it joined the family of Vonage, when it started launching its suite of API products, it launched at the same time a developer portal that went hand in hand with our API products as they came out. And the idea being that as each feature was released, whether it was the SMS API or the voice API, it would come at the same time in synchronicity with it, tutorials, code snippets, API reference, etc. And that's actually a snapshot of what that portal looked like back way, way back. It's hard to remember 2017. It's hard to remember the beginning of 2020, to be honest, let alone 2017. That beginning, that site was a custom platform. We didn't use an out-of-the-box solution, and we built it on Ruby on Rails as our framework. We chose Ruby on Rails because it was a well-trodden technical path, lots of community support. If you ran into an issue, you could Google it and probably find a plethora of Stack Overflow answers. We chose Markdown as our content format for contribution because it lowered that threshold to contribution, and it was a pretty standard formatting. And we also, back in 2017, really focused on manual testing, which meant that back then, our one technical writer and our one platform engineer spent a lot of time poring over the content and the code line by line. And all of that meant that our documentation and our code were deeply intertwined and inexplicably connected to each other. They lived in the same place, in the same repository, which had the net result of being writing content for our developer portal felt a lot like writing code. And you had to have knowledge of Ruby, knowledge of Ruby on Rails. You had to have a knowledge of web development and web applications in general to really feel confident in writing documentation for the portal. Now, if we zoom forward to 2020, what does it look like now? Well, what it looks like now is what you see on the left-hand side. And that's one of our documentation portals. That's what was Nexmo Developer, is now the Vonage API Developer Portal, which hosts our documentation for our suite of API tools, our communication API tools. And it's running on what we call Station, which is a open source platform tool that we use and we created and put out in for the community to generate numerous unique portals. We still write our content in Markdown, but now we have an open source renderer to further lower the threshold to contribution, because now you don't need to worry about the formatting in your Markdown, and our renderer takes care of it for you. All of our API reference documentation is composed in open API specification, and we have an open source renderer tool we created also to render that API docs in our each portal. And we've also really shifted to a whole suite of automated testing. And these automated testing tools check things like broken links and redirects and spelling, and of course, code checks and linting a code and all sorts of things, because we believe that we can automate the things that can be automated so that the people in our team can focus on the things that automation will ultimately never be able to do. And we've also spent a bit of time this year really thinking through internationalization as we started to add non-English content to our developer portal, starting with Chinese and with Japanese, and trying to think about ways we can turn Station to render unique portals with the ability to add content in languages that are not only English. So thinking about different character sets and also left to right and right to left and all the other considerations you need to take in when you're thinking about internationalization. internationalization. And lastly, but perhaps what I think is very important, we have separated out the code and the documentation. They now live in separate places. So if you are writing content for one of our developer portals powered by Station, you no longer need to concern yourself about the code of the platform. You can focus on the content. This is all powered, so Station is this big project. It's all powered by small tools that help us support those big goals. Namely, we're talking about three unique tools that we put out there to help power Station. One of them is, as I mentioned, our Markdown Renderer, which transforms the Markdown into fully rendered web pages. The other one is our OAS Renderer, which presents the open API specifications inside each portal instance of Station. And then we've also built a suite of custom GitHub actions and released them out there for the public to do things like check for spelling, find broken links, make sure redirects are actually working correctly, run our testing suite, and a whole lot more. So each of those small tools that we built, and we hope to add more in the coming time, is its purpose is to be a single purpose modularized component of Station. So each small little tool can be worked on, can be refactored, can be bug fixed, edited, features added, without directly impacting the whole ecosystem of Station until we are ready to push it to production. But we can do some of that work and iterate on those small modular components behind the scenes without having to cut and basically do surgery on the entire ecosystem at once. Why, though, did we do this? This was a lot of work. Why did we take our single site Ruby on Rails documentation portal and turn it into this platform generating tool that we've spent quite a bit of time, of staff time and energy building? So we did that, as many things, it began with a question. This question came to us from another part of our business that also had its own documentation, its own developer portal, and its portal was kind of running near end of life. And they turned to us, our team managing the API developer portal, and said, you know, we really like what you've done there. Is it possible that can you just copy and paste for us our content in that portal and duplicate it for us? So essentially clone that portal that you have, find and replace all the content, and then just put it up there for us. Can you please do that? It'd be so helpful. So we looked at that question and we turned to our colleagues from this other line of the business and we said, yes, with a caveat. What was the caveat? We're going to do something else. So why did we say yes, but we're going to do something else? We added that caveat for two distinct reasons. The first one is, as a team, we're a small but agile documentation team of writers and engineers. As a team, we sat down with that question and we realized that underneath that question was actually a larger adaptive question. And we could answer the technical question of, can you duplicate your portal and just put our content in it, with a technical solution, which would have been doing it. But underneath that was the question of, can you build a solution for the business writ large, right? As Vonage continues to grow and change and adapt and curveballs are thrown your way, and everyone knows this year curveballs happen, can you build something that can do that? That was really the question underlying that technical question. And we as a team wanted to build something to address that larger question. And we also realized another fundamental truth. And this data is entirely out of my own head. It doesn't correspond to actually anything published I could find, but I'm sure it resonates with some of you. It resonates surely with me, which is that there's a direct inverse relationship between the number of unique code bases, the number of unique developer sites a small agile team needs to work on, and a negative impact on that team's emotional health. So in essence, we wanted our team to be healthy, to be happy. We are overall a healthy and happy team, and we want to sustain that as we continue growing. So we wanted to address that problem, as we understood that this ask from one side of the business probably meant this ask would translate to other more requests from other sides of the business. And we were envisioning a future of multiple portals with their own unique instances of code, their own unique instances of everything, and we would need to maintain that. So those questions and the issues that we were trying to grapple with led us to Station. And how exactly does this platform tool that we call Station solve those issues for us? So first, and I think is most important, is it democratizes contribution. What I mean by that is that when you take care of all the foundations for people, you can actually focus, let people focus in contributing within their expertise and in their interest area. In other words, writing documentation is its own valuable, highly trained expertise. And somebody who writes documentation should not also have to know how to code or how to write Ruby or how to maintain a Ruby on Rails platform. They should not have to know that. If someone wants to know that, just like if an engineer wants to know the art of technical writing, they can know that as well. But it shouldn't have to be a prerequisite of their job. Similarly, from the engineer perspective, we are two platform engineers on the team. We want to make sure that we stay happy. And when we saw a problem that had multiple overlapping needs, use cases, and functionality, the engineers in us said that this is an opportunity to reduce redundancy because shared code increases developer satisfaction. So we wanted to lift up and elevate the role of technical writer and not presuppose that they must know other things beyond the expertise that they have spent years honing and really refining in their industry. And we also wanted to increase the happiness of the engineers, both now and in the future, who work on this by increasing the amount of shared code between instances. And lastly, but certainly not least, from a design and style perspective, maintaining the same look and style across multiple sites is hard. If your business has a style guide, if your business has a certain look it wants to keep, and you have multiple digital assets of which you need to maintain that look in, the more of those that are self-contained in their own bubble that you have to worry about, the higher the probability you may make a mistake in that down the road. So we wanted to reduce that chance of making that kind of mistake and make it easier for everyone, from the UX and UI designers to the graphic artists, to the writers, to the contributors, to the engineers, to maintain that same sort of business look and feel and style across the many assets that the company maintains on the web. Obviously, these were great, lofty solutions that it brought to us, and we were very happy with the results. But like everything in life, there is nothing in life that does not have its challenges. So what were some of the challenges that we came to when we started building this? And I think these really I want to focus on because they, to me, talking about the challenges are where you can really get to some of the key learnings, some of the things you can really take away from it. So first and foremost, we needed to encourage patience for adaptive solution building. Technical solutions can take less time than adaptive solutions. And you have stakeholders, whether they're internal or external or a combination of both, who are looking for something to be done. And you have to be able to find ways to cultivate that kind of patience, the resiliency of patience, as you build that adaptive solution. Furthermore, we encountered two, I would call, dialectical tensions as we were building our solution. One dialectical tension was between, on one hand, configurability, and on the other hand, standardization. The more we made Station as a platform configurable in each of its instances, the more we impacted its ability to be standardized. And we grappled and wrestled with how much configurability we wanted to offer to the instances, to each unique portal, then how we would maintain what we spoke about earlier, just a moment ago, that shared look, that shared style, that you would come to one of the portals running on Station and you would say to yourself, that's a Vonage portal. Or if you're running in your company and you come to one of the portals and you say, that's my company's portal. I see it. I can see the look. So we grappled with that tension. Similarly, we had another tension between configurability and complexity. The more that we made things configurable, we simultaneously, ipso facto, raised the level of complexity into instantiating an instance of Station as its own unique developer portal. So we had to kind of come to terms with, well, each level of configuration we offered, when you're having to boot up and initialize a portal from Station, is another thing you have to think about, another thing you have to do. So how do we grapple with that? So we address them in the following ways. When it came time to the issue of cultivating patience, we cannot emphasize enough the value of communication and communicating again. We opened up a Slack channel with a sole purpose inside the company to bring together all the stakeholders who were initially involved in this beta iteration of Station, who were the people inside the company who really wanted their new developer portal because theirs was running end of life and they were sort of our beta testers. We opened up a Slack channel with them where we could over communicate with them every step along the way, what we were working on, what was the problems we were encountering at that moment, the questions we were grappling with. And we did that a lot. We communicated a lot in that channel and with each of those people in that channel. And it also had a tangential benefit for us. And that tangential benefit was the more we communicated with the stakeholders who were most invested in the project, the more we were able to receive feedback from them as we were iterating on it. So by the time we came to a early release, the first public release of this, we had already incorporated a lot of that early feedback, which was in the end invaluable in the development lifecycle, in the feedback loop that we sort of inculcated and created by overly communicating. Secondly, when it came to those dialectical tensions that we grappled with, we came to terms with a bit of a flexible but yet somewhat standardized checklist as we ran through when we grappled with each of the items that were coming to for configuration and for customization. We asked ourselves questions like, is this item that wants to be configured or is being asked to be configured, is it common across the portals? Is it something that can be shared across all the different instances that will run off of Station? What's the level of complexity that this is going to introduce into booting up one's own developer portal from Station? Is this something that's reusable? Can it be used throughout the portals? Does it enforce or does it negatively impact the shared business style that we're trying to achieve? And I thought this was an interesting one as well. Is this a specific request from one line of the business? And if it is a specific request, is there a way that we can contour it, the way that we can shape it so that it becomes something that's more useful beyond the specificity and the idiosyncrasies of that specific request? So something that could become helpful to all the sides of the business as they were implementing their own portals off of Station. How we did the configuration is we introduced a series of configuration files that were necessary when booting up one's own instance of Station. We chose for them the content type of YAML, which stands for yet another markdown language, and recognizing that YAML in and of itself introduces some bit of complexity. YAML has, as anyone who has worked with it, its own quirks, its own sort of like nuances. But yet we knew that it was standardized. And just like when we, back in 2017, went with Ruby on Rails, and because we knew it was a well-trodden path, so too YAML is a well-trodden path. So what you're looking at on your screen is one example. We call this the business info config file. And it makes you think about, what is this site serving? What is it? What am I making here? And by answering these questions, we hope you'll actually come to some more clarity for yourself and fill in the details for your portal. So things like, what is the title of my portal? What's the base URL of it? So if in the Vonage context, all of our developer portals are something.vonage.com. So what is yours? Where's your header image? Where's your footer image? What's the alt text you would like to use for it? Where is the docs? Where are your docs in GitHub? Because Station will automatically grab them for you from GitHub and incorporate them. Where is your open API specification? So sort of like the basic questions around the shape of the business that this portal is supporting. Similarly, we have another config file we call the products file. And this one makes you think about, well, what is this portal serving? what kind of products or services am I documenting in this portal? So let's say, for example, you might have a call recording feature. If I do, then I want you to answer sort of like, what's the icon I want for that feature? What color do I want for it? And then where in my documentation is the path to the docs for that specific feature? The reason why we added that as a parameter is because oftentimes it will be parameterized, i.e. it will have a name dash something, but we can't always assume that. So we ask you to define it explicitly. And then, you know, as many of us know, there's sometimes products that are in their development that we're documenting as we work on them, but we don't necessarily want to make them publicly visible yet and highlight them and call attention to them. So we ask you in a Boolean whether that product is ready to display in your navigation. And lastly, from a platform engineering perspective, so we wanted to help the engineers who be working on each instance of this of Station, their own instance of their developer portal, to get up and running with it with as least of a frustrating experience as they possibly could. So the way we chose to do that was to use exceptions. So what you're looking at is a little piece of Ruby code that we have from Station, which basically says you need to have that business info config file defined within your documentation path. Now, technically, you could run an instance of Station without this config file of the business info, and then you would run it and it would boot up and it would look totally fine. That's the problem. It would run, but it would look fine to an extent, meaning you'd be missing some of the content. You'd be missing the title, the subtitle, the header image, so many things. And if you're the engineer in charge with trying to get this up and running, we want to give you the opportunity to fail fast, fail early with meaningful exception messaging so that you learn how and what you need to do as early as possible to trace down the things you're missing earlier than later, because from an engineering perspective, the earlier you can figure out something, the earlier you can fail and figure it out, rather than later on as you've gone further down that path, hopefully the less frustrating is that experience for you. So we mentioned that challenges often lead to takeaways. And to me, that's where like the crux of the matter is, trying to figure out what some of those key takeaways were for us and to distill them in some little bit of sound bites, if you will. And I hope these key takeaways that this process that we went through in this year, I hope some of these key takeaways are helpful for you. If you're pondering sort of the question, you're at that inflection point of how do we make our developer portal a bit more resilient, a bit more adaptable to incoming changes, whether the ones that are planned or the ones that have not been planned. So for us, I tried to distill some of those takeaways into the following. One, and this one is sort of like a foundational one for me, where you start is not where you will end. And I know that sounds like out of a fortune cookie, right? But it's so true. Where you begin your path is not where you're gonna end your path. And you may have the best laid plans, but we know what happens sometimes to the best laid plans. And trying to take that into consideration is so, so important to be able to build something that can be adaptable, something that can be fluid, something that can roll with the punches. And this year has had a lot of punches. Secondly, separating one's code and one's prose respects each contributor for their unique expertise. And I think this point cannot be emphasized enough, that a technical writer and an engineer are both incredibly valuable parts of the sort of the ecosystem of a documentation experience. And both of them should be respected for what they bring to the table, and they should not have to know each other's expertise. If they want to know, if they're interested, if they happen to know, that is wonderful. No one's saying you cannot learn something, but you should be respected for what your expertise brings to the table. And separating out those two domains allows us to lift up and elevate each of those unique and valuable professions. Thirdly, communication both increases buy-in, and what was important for us that we really experientially realized in this process was that it also improves the iteration of your development of your portal, of your tool. that the more you communicate with those who are interested in it, there's really no such thing as overly communicating. Well, maybe there is, but we haven't reached that stage yet. But the more you communicate, the better, and it helps them cultivate patience and helps you iterate on it. And lastly, and this may seem a bit reductive in its statement, but I think it is fundamentally true. Documentation needs its own documentation, or said otherwise, a portal for documentation needs to be documented. If you're going to create a documentation portal, it would be a bit sad if you also didn't create documentation for the documentation portal. Say that three times fast. So the way in which we did that is really in a two-pronged method. On one hand, we created public documentation for the portal, for Station itself, and we chose to put it on GitHub pages and link to it from the README of the GitHub repo itself, where Station lives, and we update that public documentation as things update. We don't even, like, within our own Station, within our own small sort of internal product that we've open sourced, we don't consider a feature in Station to be done unless it is also documented here. So we document, for example, all the files you need, the config files, the ways you can customize it. And even, for example, that point, the number 3, configuring the feedback widget, that just went live on Monday. And we went live with it on Monday. It's a new widget as part of Station to create a feedback experience to collect and analyze and report on the feedback that you receive as part of your portal, developer portal experience. And we, as we went live with it, we also went live with documentation. And secondly, we offer a bootstrap doc portal product on GitHub that can be cloned. And in that bootstrap doc portal is everything you need to get up and running with your own documentation portal. So if you're trying to figure out how to do this, you might, people learn different modalities, people have different ways of learning things. Some learn by reading first, and others learn by doing first and then reading to make up for all the mistakes that they made because they didn't read the documentation to begin with. I may be in that latter category. So that lets the person Git clone this bootstrap doc portal, try and get their hands dirty and figure it out. And then at the same time, they have the documentation available for them to get them out of the muck when they inevitably run into the muck. So what's next for us? Where is in our 2021 planning, as much as planning is helpful considering life is what it is, where are we thinking about and growing Station and adding to what it can do for both internally for our product lines, but also since we brought it out to the public, what it can do for anyone who might want to use it? Well, the thing we're really thinking about now is to know thyself. We do this already. We understand some of the settings that you choose as you run through using a documentation portal running on Station. So if you've clicked, for example, on PHP when you're looking at a code snippet, we'll remember that and we'll show you PHP snippets first, right, for example. But we want to grow that user personalization. We want to know you more, because the more we can understand what you're looking for, the more we can understand who you are and what you're seeking, the greater we can impact and hopefully positively grow your learning experience on the portal. So some of that means we want to create more of a bilateral fluid connection between our portal and our dashboard, right? Like a lot of companies have a customer dashboard, which contains very good information like API credentials, or contains information around customers' preference settings. If we can create a bilateral relationship between those two things and they can feed into each other, we can use that to create a portal that actually feels like it's yours. When you go to that portal, it knows you. That's our goal for 2021. We have a lot of sub tickets in our Jira Kanban board for what we're going to do to accomplish each of those specific tasks under it. But really, writ large, the goal is to know thyself, to know who is coming to it. So I want to leave you with some resources as we conclude. As I mentioned, this is an open source tool. If you would like to use it, we welcome it. If you run into bugs or run into feature requests, you're welcome to raise them as issues on GitHub. You can find it on GitHub. You can also use it, install it as a Ruby gem. A Ruby gem is sort of a package executable that you can include in your documentation site. And that's all you need to include along with the configuration files. The documentation lives on GitHub Pages. That we have a link here for the portal, the Bootstrap portal project that you can clone to get started. And currently within our business, we have two instances running off of Station live and in production. One is what I showed you a screenshot of, which is developer.vonage.com, our Vonage API developer portal. And then we also have a consumer product, the Vonage Business Communications portal, developer.uc.vonage.com, which is also running on portal, which is also running a portal off of Station. And we hope to have more in the business integrate and adopt this down the road in the first half of 2021. Thank you so much for your time. I'm so grateful for it, and I look forward to any questions or comments you may have. Please be in touch. You can find me on Twitter, or you can email me, and I know we'll have a question time now and an unconference later, and I really look forward to engaging with each and every one of you. Thank you very much.